Thank you. Happy Easter and welcome to Washington National Cathedral. My name is Randy Hollerith and I'm the Dean of the Cathedral. And on behalf of Mariann Budde, the Bishop of the Diocese of Washington and all of us here at the Cathedral, we hope that you have a wonderful and blessed Easter, this day of hope and promise and resurrection. While the building is still closed and we miss having all of you with us here inside, I remember that last year we were closed as well and the pandemic was raging, and this Easter service, while always joyful, was rather Spartan. I'm so grateful that this year we are able to do more, and so grateful first and foremost to our altar guild for the incredible flowers that we have around us this Easter Sunday. As you can see, what a great blessing they are to all of us. And I'm also so grateful to our choristers and our musicians. We are able this year to have more choristers and musicians than we were last year. So what a great opportunity this is. And so for all of you who live in the area, don't forget that after the 11:15 service today, beginning at 1 o'clock, you are all invited to drive by or walk up to the cathedral and receive communion outside. We're calling it curbside communion on this Easter Sunday. And after a year of not receiving communion, what a great honor and treat it is for us to be able to share the body of Christ with our brothers and sisters. So I hope that you will come and be with us. But wherever you are around the country, please know that you are part of our cathedral family, and we're so glad that you have joined us for this morning's worship. Now let us take a deep breath, center ourselves, and prepare ourselves to worship. Thank you.
In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
The Lord is great.
Hallelujah. There's nobody like him nowhere.
So I worship him with all I've got.
I gotta give him honor, cause he is the only true and living God.
Oh, yeah. Let's give him honor.
His name is great. Let's
bow down.
Come on, let's give him the praise.
Shout loud, lift your voice, speak well.
And bless his holy name. Tell everybody of his excellent greatness. The Lord is great, the Lord is great, and great to be praised. Come on, come on, let's give it.
Dear friends, today we celebrate the glorious resurrection of Jesus Christ, his triumphant victory over sin and death. May the light of Christ, who rises this day in glory, scatter the darkness of our hearts and minds. Christ yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, by his holy and glorious wounds, may Christ our Lord guard us and keep us. Amen. O God, through your Son, you have bestowed upon your people the brightness of your light. Sanctify and bless this candle. May it shine continually to drive away all darkness. Christ is risen from the dead, and his flame of love still burns within us. Christ sheds his peaceful light on all the world. Christ lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread through Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went out doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not only to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, and everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of his sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which in turn you have received, in which you also stand, through which you are also being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you what was of first importance, when in turn I had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters all at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all of the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he also appeared to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Santo Evangelio de nuestro Señor Jesucristo según Juan.
Gloria a ti, Cristo Señor.
El primer día de la semana, María Magdalena fue al sepulcro muy temprano, cuando todavía estaba oscuro, y vio quitada la piedra que tapaba la entrada. Entonces se fue corriendo a donde estaban Simón Pedro y el otro discípulo, aquel a quien Jesús quería mucho, y les dijo: «Se han llevado del sepulcro al Señor, y no sabemos dónde lo han puesto». Pedro y el otro discípulo salieron y fueron al sepulcro. Los dos iban corriendo juntos, pero el otro corrió más que Pedro y llegó primero al sepulcro. Se agachó a mirar y vio allí las vendas, pero no entró. Detrás de él llegó Simón Pedro y entró en el sepulcro. Él también vio allí las vendas y además vio que la tela que había servido para envolver la cabeza de Jesús no estaba junto a las vendas, sino enrollada y puesta aparte. Entonces entró también el otro discípulo, el que había llegado primero al sepulcro, y vio lo que había pasado y creyó, pues todavía no habían entendido lo que dice la Escritura, que él tenía que resucitar. Luego, aquellos discípulos regresaron a su casa. María se quedó afuera, junto al sepulcro, llorando. Y llorando como estaba, se agachó para mirar dentro y vio dos ángeles, vestidos de blanco, sentados donde había estado el cuerpo de Jesús, uno a la cabeza y otro a los pies. Los ángeles le preguntaron: «Mujer, ¿por qué lloras?». Ella les dijo: «Porque se han llevado a mi Señor y no sé dónde lo han puesto». Apenas dijo esto, volvió la cara y vio allí a Jesús, pero no sabía que era Él. Jesús le preguntó: «Mujer, ¿por qué lloras? ¿A quién buscas?». Ella, pensando que era el que cuidaba el huerto, le dijo: «Señor, si usted se lo ha llevado, dígame dónde lo ha puesto, para que yo vaya a buscarlo». Jesús entonces le dijo: «María». Ella se volvió y le dijo en hebreo: «Rabuni», que quiere decir maestro. Jesús le dijo: «No me retengas, porque todavía no he ido a reunirme con mi Padre. Pero ve y di a mis hermanos que voy a reunirme con el que es mi Padre y Padre de ustedes, mi Dios y Dios de ustedes». Entonces María Magdalena fue y contó a los discípulos que había visto al Señor, y también les contó lo que Él le había dicho.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw that the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the risen Christ, amen. Given all that you're holding in your heart right now, and all that's happening in our world, it might help to know or remember that resurrection is a process more than an event. And it begins while it's still dark. The first stirrings of a new life, new hope and possibility in the wake of loss, those stirrings are generally hidden from us. It's like the sprouts from a seed that haven't yet broken through the soil, or the healing that's taking place deep within our bodies while on the surface we're still in pain. You may not feel anything at all this Easter morning. Not to worry. Think of Mary rising early that morning, that first Easter morning, rising if she ever slept at all, making her way towards Jesus' tomb while it was still dark with no expectation that there would be anything other than the somber work of grief waiting for her there. But that's how resurrection began for her, below the surface of her expectations. We often speak of Mary as the first witness to the resurrection, which she was, but she was more than that. Walking toward the tomb while it was still dark, Mary was as much a part of that first resurrection as Jesus rising from the dead. She was rising too. And rest assured that God will summon us as well, wake us up in the middle of the night if need be, and propel us forward before we realize that anything has changed. God will do this. God will get us moving so that we don't miss the opportunity to choose life again. Movement is key in resurrection. I think our bodies know before our minds do that something is stirring. Both Jesus and Mary were moving forward, you know. "Don't hold on to me, Mary," he said to her when they met at last in the garden. There was no looking back for him. There was no standing still, only forward movement. That's how it is with resurrection. A friend said to me recently, "I will go anywhere as long as it's forward." That's the stirring of resurrection. Now, in the third chapter of the Gospel of John, Jesus says that we can only speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen. So if we're to speak of resurrection, we have to experience it. And I've been thinking all week about what I can say from experience about resurrection. And this is still a work in progress, but here goes. First, a bit about the context. We live in a world of such profound contradiction, intense beauty, and harsh, unforgiving natural phenomenon. A seemingly natural order of things and mind-boggling chaos. Within myself and every other person I know, there lies the full range of human possibility, our highest aspirations, our most base behavior, and not to mention, as Annie Leonoff once said, all that is mediocre and merely boring. It's all inside us. As human beings, we're capable of the most exquisite artistic expression, scientific discovery, physical accomplishment, and of stunning mean-spiritedness, petty cruelty, and acts of war. We're both self-centered and altruistic. We're stingy and generous. We're anxious and brave. We like to think of ourselves as independent thinkers. And yet we are susceptible to forces of sophisticated manipulation that prey on insecurities and have us herd together and do all sorts of things in a crowd that we would never do on our own. We are, spiritually speaking, both saint and sinner. We can be hopelessly lost and miraculously found. And there is more suffering in this world than any heart should hold. None of us is spared suffering, some of which we bring on ourselves, much we cause others through personal and systemic patterns that Scripture calls sin, all the ways we fail one another, ourselves, and God. And so, into this wondrous, confusing, beautiful, broken God world and life, God comes to us. And to those called to follow him, God comes in the person of Jesus. And just as he came as a human being 2,000 years ago now, who, as the author of Acts describes him, went around doing good, he comes to us now as the risen Christ. He comes in solidarity, he comes with forgiveness, comes with unconditional love, and these gifts of resilience and mercy and grace. But he doesn't take away our suffering. I wish that he did, but he doesn't. What he does is hold it with us, and he goes down with us when we're forced to go all the way down, you know, to the point of death, our physical death, certainly, but also all the other ways we experience death in this life. And there we sit. And then, while it's still dark, we realize that we're rising and we're moving without knowing how we got started. And it begins to dawn on us as we move that something might be different, that something new is happening. It's as if for a time we're carried or led, invited to walk through a door that we didn't know was there. And it's not clear, it doesn't feel familiar, and sometimes we hold back. We actually resist this because we've grown accustomed to the dark. But whatever it is that's stirring in us beckons us on and we go. There is sorrow involved here, and a part of us doesn't want to go for a whole host of reasons, but this energy is propelling us forward toward life. It's not an easy road because life is never easy, but it's life. It's life for us to choose and to live. Now, my first experiences of what theologians call this cruciform reality of death and resurrection that we live over and over again, both personally and communally. My first experience of this were very small, and they were deeply personal. I've known death of a dream. I've known death of relationships. I've lost some physical capabilities that were precious to me. And losses of other kinds. In the midst of a devastating loss at the time, I stumbled into a church. It happened to be Easter Sunday. And I heard this sermon about little deaths and little resurrections, a kind of corny sermon, actually, in which the preacher described these things that happen to us as practice for the ultimate resurrection that awaits us at the end. And there was just something in his words, or God stirring, I don't know, but I felt for the first time in months that I was willing to believe that I could live again. And amazingly so, life came back, and I felt myself rise toward it, toward a new life that God had begun in and for me. It wasn't the first time I had experienced that kind of death, and it certainly wasn't the last. And you'd think it would get easier with experience, but you know, with each loss, the loss is just as fresh. Each journey through the dark is just as dark as the last. But it does become familiar. It's one of the reasons why we circle around this story every single year to remind ourselves what it's like. And so that it becomes for us a way of life and a way of looking at the world through this prism of the cross and resurrection. And that's something to hold on to right now, this cross and resurrection rhythm and pattern of life, because we are on the precipice now as a people of so much stirring, so much suffering all around us. And it's important that we remember that resurrection is not an individual journey alone. It is communal. And as important as our individual stories of resurrection are, and they are important, in God's dream, resurrection is for all of us, toward what Jesus called the kingdom of God here on earth, what Martin Luther King called the beloved community, a world aligned with God's dream, with God's love, God's justice for all humankind. And just as we have a part to play in our own rising, we have a part to play in this communal rising up, this planting of the kingdom of God, this fruition of the beloved community. And it happens whenever we find ourselves or place ourselves, as Jesus did, in situations of suffering or of brokenness or injustice, when we accept it, accept that suffering as the cost of love and of not only our personal transformation, but societal transformation as well. That's when resurrection flows through us. We show up in places that are beyond hope, or where it seems that there is no hope, where it's still dark and we don't see anything. And when resurrection occurs there, stirred by a power that is not ours, we're among those walking toward a new horizon with other people, toward a dream that God has for us all. And no one knew that better. No one knew that promise of communal suffering and resurrection better than Martin Luther King Jr., who was assassinated 53 years ago today, April 4th, 1968. Such a poignant contrast to have Easter celebration on that day of such searing memory. But it's a fitting one, I think, after a year of so much loss. I can't stop thinking about King and that last week of his life that began right here in this pulpit and ended with a bullet on the balcony of the Lorraine Hotel. You see, King believed in the power of what he called redemptive suffering. Suffering, like Jesus, for love and for justice, for peace and goodwill among all people. He walked in faith while it was still dark. Now, he wasn't a perfect man, we know that, but he never seemed to waver from this path of sacrificial love and redemptive suffering. He believed it for himself, for his own people, and incredibly enough, in his generous heart, for everyone else. He never gave up on love. And his faith, while it was communal, was also deeply personal. One of the last requests he made before he died, apparently, was for the singer Mahalia Jackson to sing his favorite song at that night's prayer meeting. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Help me stand. Through the dark, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me on. I'm persuaded that God calls each one of us, just like that, to walk toward the dawn while it's still dark. Jesus taking our hand, trusting that it will not always be night for ourselves or for others, because that is God's dream. And it's our way of living on this earth until then, as best we can, in sacrificial and healing love. So no matter where you are on this resurrection journey, take heart this Easter morning. Christ is risen, and so have you. God is God, and by the grace of God, you are who you are, called to walk with Jesus toward the light, even while it's still dark. And so now, let the words that brought such hope and reassurance to Dr. King speak to you now. Let the risen Lord take your hand and lead you on to the light of resurrection. Amen.
gracious Lord, take my hand, take that child unto thee with my dream of a world that is free.
Now let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Rejoicing in the resurrection of Christ, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. We lift up the words of our brother Martin Luther King Jr. as he prayed for the day when this nation and the world would truly reflect the kingdom of God. O God, our gracious Heavenly Father, we come on this Easter morning thanking thee for revealing to us the ultimate meaning and the ultimate rationality of the universe. We thank you this morning for your Son, Jesus, who came by to let us know that love is the most durable power in the world. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
We thank thee for thy church, founded upon thy word, that challenges us to do more than sing and pray, but to go out and work, proclaiming the gospel of the risen Christ to a suffering world. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
God grant that here in this nation and all over the world, we choose the high way. A way in which we live together as sisters, brothers, and siblings. A way in which every nation will allow justice to run down like waters, and righteousness like a mighty stream, a way in which all will do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
Grant that civic leaders and those in authority all over this nation, especially Joseph, President of the United States, will rise up and use their talents that God has given them to lead the people on toward the promised land of freedom. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
On this Easter hope, reveal your grace and healing power to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially those with chronic illnesses and COVID-19, that they may be surrounded by God's love and comfort. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
We thank thee for the lives of great saints and prophets in the past. We give thanks for the life of Martin Luther King Jr., for his work for racial equality, justice, and peace, to build the beloved community. Help us never to let any condition pull us so low as to cause us to hate or forget that we are all children of God. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for all who have gone before us in the faith and the Easter hope of resurrection, who now rest from their labors that they may find the blessed rest of everlasting peace. Jesus, Lord of life,
hear our prayer.
O God, our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank thee for the inspiration of Jesus the Christ, who came to this world to show us the way of love. Keep us, we pray, in perfect peace. Help us to walk together, pray together, sing together, and live together until that day when all God's children will rejoice in our common bond of humanity in the kingdom of our Lord and of our God. We offer our prayers and hopes in the name of the one who gave us eternal life and joy, your Son, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Once again, good morning and happy Easter to all of you. Thank you for being with us today. It is a joyful day here at the Cathedral, and I hope a joyful day for all of you as well. A special thank you to all those who made it possible for the Cathedral this week to provide 140 meals for 140 families over this Easter holiday. Thank you for that support. And thank you to all of you who around the country who support the work of this cathedral. It means a great deal to all of us. If you value the services and the programs and the music and all that we do here in the cathedral, we can really use your help. With the building still being closed and so many streams of revenue having disappeared, we want to continue doing the work that we do. And all the money that we raise here at the cathedral comes from good people like you. So on this Easter Sunday, I hope that you will first and foremost support your own church or your own local community. And then afterwards, if you're able to support the cathedral, we would be so grateful. We put all that money to good use to continue to reach out in love and care to folks across this great country. So thanks to all of you for the support you have given us. And may God bless you. Now remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, how he said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive."
rose again. The only king whose reign will never end. He reigns over all the earth. 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 All hail the King of
the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is a right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, 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 holy.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us join our voices in prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving as I proclaim your resurrection. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into my heart. May I live in you and you in me, in this life and in the life to come. Amen. Praying together. God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now may the gift of the risen Christ fill your heart this day with joy, with confidence and resolve to continue walking Jesus' way of love. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.